So I would welcome you all to the Salesforce journey, right? Today we'll just have a brief understanding of what is Salesforce and what are its advantages, right? In coming few slides, I'll let you know what all the takeaway points that you can take away from this demo session, right? So till that point, we'll just understand what exactly the Salesforce is. And at the end of the session, you would be able to understand what Salesforce is doing in real-time environments, right? And what is the use of this software in real-time scenarios, all right? So once again, good morning to everyone, right? So I would quickly introduce myself. My name is Sandeep. I've been into Salesforce technology for almost 6 years. I've been working in two major projects, right? And we have built it from scratch. That means from zero till the live environment. So from zero to 100 is what we have built. And I've been part of 6 minor releases, which is a kind of a subversion to the main release that we have released. It's a kind of a version like 1.1, 1.2. I've been part of 6 such releases. And one good thing that I've worked on is, so every year Salesforce conducts a kind of a major event, which is called Dreamforce. So if you ask me what exactly the Dreamforce is, it is a one-time event that one every year Salesforce conducts a bigger event where people would be getting to know what are the latest updates that Salesforce is planning to release. And also it will give us the chance, like the developers who are using Salesforce, to expo their expertise in that session. So it is like you come up with an idea and you have an opportunity to present that idea. And I've been part of one project that we have demonstrated in the Dreamforce. And yeah, so I've been into teaching field for almost 4 years, right? So I've been teaching Salesforce for almost 4 years, and I've already trained 100 plus people, and 100 plus people have properly migrated from other industries to Salesforce. All right, that is all about myself. I'm quickly moving on to the next slide. Let me know if you can see it. All right, so how many people agree to this point? Information is wealth. Feel free to ping Y. If you agree to that, is there any issue for people? I see 2 people raising hands. All right, feel free to ping yes or no, right? You can type in yes if you agree to this point. You can type in no if you don't agree to this point, right? There is a small story I'll just explain here, right? And then we'll understand. Okay, Shiva M., is there any connectivity issue, or is it just that you're not able to see the screen? I see other people responding well. Shiva, I am just check your connectivity, or else feel free to rejoin the session. You would be able to see it. All right. So we'll just understand one common scenario or one real-time scenario where we'll understand how much the information plays a crucial role in the business. All right. So there is this ABC company called, all right, yeah. So yeah, is my voice audible to everyone? So Sai Prasanna, check your internet connectivity or feel free to join it again, because the rest of people were able to hear me properly. So I'll just proceed. Let me know if you have any concerns. All right. All right. So I would take a dummy company here, right? A imaginary company called ABC. What they're doing, they are basically setting up fences around the houses, right? So their company is basically providing fencing around the houses, right? So what is fencing? If you look at any countries which are like towards the western side of our world, they usually have a perimeter set up around their house, marking their territory, right? Usually fences will be like this, the kind of a steel mesh or a kind of a wooden parameter that they set around the houses. What this ABC company is doing, ABC company is basically setting up that fences, or they're leasing out this fencing, right? So setting up the parameter is a one-time activity. They usually come there, set up the parameter, set up the fences, and they would charge certain amount. And these people, client people who are asking the ABC company to install that fencing, they would basically pay that ABC company and the deal is closed, right? So if they're leasing it out on a contract basis, that means they're basically leasing these fences for a certain amount of time, they would do an agreement saying that this fence would be installed from this date to this date, and this is what we are charging per square meter or whatever the measurable parameter that they have, they'll charge accordingly, right? Now, how come this information is valid statement here? Right, so this ABC company is basically using certain tools to save their information, right? So when they're leasing out a fence, right, for let's say house one, they have leased out a fence of, let's say, 20 square feet, right? I'm just taking a assumptionary number here, right? How they're saving this information, they're saving it either on the slippy note, right, the yellow LED sticky notes that we see, or on a local machine Excel sheet, right? When I say local, it is very specific to that particular laptop or a desktop. How they're saving this information, let's say house one has installed a leased out a fence for 20 square feet, and they have installed, let's say, on July 6th, 2019, right? For an example, I'm taking this information. How they're saving, either on a sticky note or an Excel sheet, right? So now what happens, since it's a one year from the day that they have installed that fences, if the technician or the salesperson is going to that house to understand if there is any, if the house one people want to continue their service, what happens? They would tell the customer that it's a mark of 1 year. Would you like to extend the contract? Is what this person will ask. ABC representative will ask. What the client would say, he will definitely forget that information, and he'll say he is not sure that whether he has installed it on 6th July or maybe on 6th of August, right? Because of that, what is happening is this ABC company is losing that information, right? So the person who is visiting that location is not having the proper information before visiting that house, right? So he'll basically go to that house, and he, without that proper information, he is in a dilemma whether to say to the client that this is the fencing that was installed at 6th June 2019, and it is 1 year of that particular fence installation, and he doesn't have the right information to say that this is the proper date than when it was installed, right? Because the information is not properly gathered in a such a way that whenever this ABC representative visiting the client location, it doesn't have the necessary information to show the client saying that this is the date when it was installed, and it is a 1 year from that date, right? Because of that, what is happening, ABC company is losing one year's of revenue. Let's say if they are saying that they want to extend that contract, and the client is saying that no, he has installed it on 6th August 2019, it's a 1 month of revenue that ABC company is losing, right? Because of that, because of information not properly gathered and not properly organized, they're losing that information or losing that wealth, right? Because of that particular information that is missing, that ABC representative was not able to properly confirm that it has been installed at so and so date, the company is using 1 month's of revenue, right? Imagine what would happen if there are like hundreds of clients who are doing the same thing. It is not because of they're basically violating or they're exploiting this ABC company. It is the information gap that is there, right? How many people agree to this statement? Because of that, there is a huge loss that would be incurred for this ABC company, just because the data was not properly organized and they are not able to basically go through a certain process saying that this is the information, valid information that we have in the system. According to this one, this is the end date for your contract, and you should be renewing it within few days, right? Because of this, assume that if this happens for hundreds of people, 100 into 1 month of revenue is equal to, it would be in lots of rupees or lots of dollars, right? So this is why information gathering is important, but saving them in an organized way so that whenever it is required, it should be used. I would say right information at the right point of time would give you the right results, right? Right information at the right point of time will give you right results. How many people agree to this statement? All right. Awesome. So towards the end, right, if we get time, I'll try to give you a solution to this one, right? So we'll understand what is the issue. By this scenario that I've given you, you might have got what was the real-time issue here. The real-time issue is not information gathering. It is information structuring and providing the right information to the right person at the right point of time is the problem statement or the solution to the problem statement, right? Towards the end, we'll try to understand how Salesforce is providing a solution to this one, right? This is our problem statement. Towards the end of our demo, we'll try to understand how we are providing a solution to this one, right? If people don't have any doubts, I'll quickly move on to the next slide. If you have anything, just do let me know, right? So we have understood the problem statement now, right? In this demo, if you ask me what are the key takeaways that I'll be getting as a part of this demo, these are the key takeaways, right? So we'll understand what is Salesforce, right? When I say what is Salesforce, you'll be able to understand what is Salesforce, and you'll be able to explain people. If they ask you what is Salesforce, you will be in a position to explain them what is exactly the Salesforce is, right? And we'll also understand what is CRM. Then we'll understand, you people might have got a understanding saying that CRM is a kind of a something that uses CRM, right? We'll understand why is Salesforce marked as number one in the CRM, right? We'll understand that point as well. Then comes, if it is marked as number one, when I say Salesforce is number one in the CRM, you should also understand the advantages that you get as a part of opting Salesforce as your CRM, right? That is the next thing that we'll be taking a look at. And last but not the least, which is an important one for everyone, which is the career opportunities in Salesforce. We'll understand what are the career opportunities that we have in Salesforce. All right. So these are the things that we'll be looking at. Let me know if you have any questions on this one. Right. So I would pause here for a second. Right. I would like you people to just have a look at these questions and understand the importance of these questions. Right. Understand the importance of these questions. The reason why I'm stressing on these points is, if you learn any new technology, you should understand what are its advantages or the applications of this, application of this application, right? So you should understand where exactly it is used and what problem it is solving in the real time, right? Let's say after learning, so XYZ technology, right? If it is into data storage, and if you think that at the end of that, if you think that this is, this technology can be used for developing a game, that doesn't make any sense, right? So if you understand the entire Salesforce, at the end of the day, if you ask me a question saying that, can I develop a game on Salesforce? There is a chance that you can do it, but it is not mainly meant for that, right? So we'll understand what is the scope for the Salesforce in the real-time scenarios. Then we'll understand how exactly it has been in the top, right, for a while. Because if you ask anyone on the CRM, right, if you ask what are the technologies that you need to learn, if you ask very specific questions saying that what is one technology that I learn that I need to learn in CRM, which will get me a job or which will put me in a right position so that I have a longer career, they would simply say Salesforce, right? We need to understand why exactly the Salesforce is marked as number one, right? If you understand that question, then you'll get to know what is the good things that Salesforce done in the past so that it was marked as number one, right? Some good things in the past it has done, it was marked as number one. Now, the next thing that you need to understand is, if it is marked as number one CRM technology, right? Now, what are the things that is doing in the future so that it will retain that position? It is not that one time if I get a first rank, it doesn't mean that I'm a topper, right? It is a consistent performance that we need to put in order to retain that position, right? So those are the things that we'll be learning in the next couple of slides. So shall I move on to the next slide? Are there any questions or shall I move on to the next slide? All right. I hope, Shivayam, you are able to see the screen now, right? Okay. Now comes the interesting question, what is Salesforce, right? Till now, we were able to understand the problem statement. We are trying to understand the solution that we are trying to provide. Now comes the bigger question, which says, what is Salesforce, right? If I have to explain it in a simpler terminology, Salesforce is a cloud-based CRM solution that brings companies and customers together. I would repeat, Salesforce is a cloud-based CRM solution that brings companies and customers together, right? Now, if I look at the statement, apart from the Salesforce word, I see four terminologies that I need to discuss, right? What are those four? One is the cloud-based, second one is a CRM solution, third one is companies and customers, right? Now, I will ask you a quick question to everyone, right? Feel free to use your chat windows to let me know what is your thought on this, right? Why do you think that Salesforce has to bring customers and companies together, right? What is the background thought process of Salesforce to put in their statement saying that Salesforce is a cloud-based CRM solution that brings customers and companies together, right? Forget about the part of what exactly the Salesforce is here. It is saying that it's a cloud-based CRM solution, but what is the next part is talking about? The next part is basically saying that bringing customers and companies together. Why it is saying like that, right? So if you look at the previous problem statement, we were talking about a business line, right? So ABC company is doing a business because of which there is an information that is coming in. And now Salesforce, what exactly it is doing? It is trying to save that information in a structured way and in a way that the end users can use it, or end users or the representatives of the ABC company use it at the right information at the right point of time. All right. So the Salesforce main initiative here is to basically make sure that the business is being properly organized. The information or the business flow is properly organized in terms of information, right? Why do you think that companies should understand their customers? Why do you think that companies should understand their customers, right? So it is saying that it is trying to bring the customers and companies together, right? Answer is very simple. If the business or the company can understand their end customer, if they know what the customer needs, they can serve their end customer better. Right? Is that right or not? If I know my end customer, if he's trying to basically purchase a laptop, right? If I know what he exactly is needing, like what exactly he is looking for, right? So he wants a kind of a machine that is portable and where he can use it is his requirement, then I can basically project my laptops to him, right? I can say that these are the variety of the laptops that we are providing, and I can just give him an option to select one, right? If he is looking for a kind of a machine which is at a one particular point and he doesn't have a requirement of moving that machine from one place to another, then there is no point of me projecting a laptop to him. Instead, I can basically show him my desktop features or the number of varieties of a desktops that vendor has, right? So it is always a good aspect to understand your customer and then sell what he needs, right? Is that making sense or not? Is that making sense? All right. This is a kind of interactive session. Feel free to just use your hand. I see people using their hands. Feel free to use the chat window as well so that we'll understand it little better. All right. Okay. Now we have understood the part where companies needs to understand their customers, because their business would be growing if they understand what the customer needs are. Now, what is Salesforce? It is bringing the customers and companies together with the help of cloud-based CRM solution. Now, we have understood the other two aspects. Only two aspects are remaining, which is cloud-based and CRM now, right? Cloud-based is a kind of a separate discussion that we'll be having in our day one session. For now, I'm just keeping that aside. Now, in the coming slides, we'll understand what is CRM. If you remember the questions that I've put in the key takeaways, the second question was, after what is Salesforce, we have a question saying that what is CRM, right? So I'll quickly go on to that slide and we'll try to understand what is CRM. Then we'll come back to understand the statement properly, right? So for that reason, I'm just quickly moving on to the next slide, which is what is CRM, right? So CRM full form is customer relationship management. If you ask me what is CRM, it is the shorter version of customer relationship management. As per the definition, what it says, customer relationship management is a technology for managing all your company's relationships and interactions with customers and potential customers, right? So in a business, what people will do, business people and the end customers, there would be an interaction between them. The interaction would be the business interaction that would happen, right? So what is this CRM helping us? CRM is helping us in managing all the customer relationships, all the company's relationship and interactions with the customers and the potential customers, right? So there are like two types of customers that have been highlighted in this statement. One is a normal customer and another one is a potential customer, right? So if you think from a business perspective, there would be people who are already opting for that service, and there might be people who are looking out to buy certain products. Let's say if I take an example of a AC machine, right? So if I take a company called Blue Star, there might be people who are already using that Blue Star as an AC product, right? And there might be some people who are looking out to buy a AC product, right? For the Blue Star, the people who are already using, let's say if there are 50 people who are already using that Blue Star as a product, they are their existing customers. And let's say 10 people are looking out for buying a AC as a product, right? Then the 10 people become their potential customers. Why they are named as potential customers? Because there might be the people who might be turning into their existing customers. If they can, Blue Star company, if they can sell that AC product to them, they becomes their existing customers. The number 10 will be coming into the 50 account, right? 50 plus the people who are converted into that existing customers. It is nothing but the potential customers are nothing but future customers. If you can sell your product to them, they become your existing customers, right? So that is all about the CRM. In short, what exactly, if you ask me what exactly the CRM is all is doing, is it is trying to save that information, or it's trying to basically hold all the information that is coming in during the process of the business, right? I'll show you what exactly that in the next slide, right? We have a small example to demonstrate the same. So there are lots of information that comes in, right? If it is a future customer or a potential customer, they would be asking so many details, right? Like what is the cost of that AC machine and how much do you charge for installation and how much time, how much power it consumes, or how many times do I need to do the service? There are a lot many of questions that I'll be asking, right? There is a lots of information that comes in, right? The CRM helps us basically manage all these interactions and the relationship with the customers, right? This is all about CRM. Now, in order to ease out the understanding of what exactly the CRM is, I have a next slide, which basically helps us understand in detail of what exactly the CRM is. All right. Now, in this slide, what I'm doing is I'm taking an ABC company, right? Why am I taking ABC company? I'm not biased. I'm just taking this company so that I don't get into trouble, right? Right. So that is one reason, that is why I'm just taking this company. Now, what is this ABC company doing? This ABC company is basically manufactured ABC computers, right? So what exactly it did? It has produced a desktop and it named it as ABC Computers, right? So this ABC company did some analysis and found out some flaws in the other systems, other vendors, and they have come up with a new product. New product as in new features and new specifications in the desktop, right? So they have named it as ABC Computers. Now, for this company to sustain in this market, what exactly they need to what exactly should be the next steps of this ABC company to get the revenue back into the system, right? So the question here is, what exactly should be the next step of this ABC company so that this ABC computers would be sold out from their warehouse? So once they manufacture, they'll store it somewhere. Now, what are the next step of the things or next step of actions that the ABC needs to look at so that they sell this ABC computers to the end customer? So how many people understood the question and trying to think of an answer? How many people understood the question and just trying to think an answer to it? All right. Awesome. All right. The question, answer to the question can be anything. You can say that they should basically shut down the unit. That is also fine, right? That is also a good answer, but it not be a right answer. Feel free to just ping me or unmute your mic and let me know what exactly your thought is. Then we'll try to understand from, we'll move from the good answer to the right answer. All right. Now, think from a ABC company perspective. What is the next thing that they need to do so that people will get to know there is an ABC company? Because if ABC company has manufactured something and people will don't know what exactly I'm doing at my warehouse, if I'm the ABC company owner, right? If I have the things that are manufactured in my warehouse and I'm keeping there, who would get to know there is a beautiful product called ABC computers at my warehouse? People will not get to know that. For that, what we need to do? We need to first do marketing, right? Why we need to do marketing? Because there are companies which are already providing a desktop to the people, right? Dell is also providing that. HP is also providing that. Lenovo is doing that for a while, right? There are so many companies which are already doing this one. For the people to understand there is a new product or a new option that is provided to them, they need to do marketing, right? If you ask me what are the ways of doing marketing, we usually get YouTube ads, right? And the traditional way of doing marketing is to distribute the pamphlets. And the next way of doing things is to basically do a referral kind of a marketing where you buy you purchase a product and you'll tell your other friend saying that there is a product that is there and they're giving it a discount and that particular product is a beautiful product. A kind of a referral marketing would be there. If you see the big companies, they usually do the events where they'll do a kind of a launch events. They would bring in a celebrity and they'll ask them to basically release that product. And finally, they would put in a big hoardings in the dense traffic area so that people will get to know that there is an option that is there for them. So if you see, this marketing segment is mainly focusing on one aspect. It is focusing on one aspect, that is nothing but letting the people know that there is an option that is there apart from the regular items that we have, right? So in the desktop segment, there is this ABC company which is newly launched, which is competing with the other competitors, is what this marketing main goal is, right? So once the marketing is done, what should be the next thing? That they need to do? So once the marketing is done, if I am the person who is purchasing that ABC computers, if I'm looking for a desktop, the next thing that I'll look at is I'll basically compare the prices, right? I'll compare Dell desktop version. I'll compare it with ABC computers. I'll basically do a comparison, and depending on my budget and depending on the time when I want this particular machine installed at my home, and plus other factors like if I have the service center nearby or not, based on certain factors, I'll get to a conclusion. right? So if I want to get to know the specs of it, what all things that I'll be doing, I'll be going to an e-commerce site to basically understand that specs, or I'll land up on their main landing page, company's landing page, right? Company's website, right? Where I'll get to know the specifications of this particular product. Or one more way of doing it is I'll basically walk into a store where I can get to see this product, and I'll get to get the look and feel of it, right? So this is the these are the things that we'll do before getting into a conclusion whether to buy a product or not, right? These are the things that we'll do. Now, once you have basically understood what exactly that you are looking at, and you'll basically walk to a store, understand if that product is available and how much discount that you'll get, and you'll basically ask them for a price. They'll give you a quotation saying that this is the marked price on it, and this is the discount that we are giving because it is a new product that has been launched. Or they might say that this is a festival offer that we are giving to you, and at this rate, right? Once you are happy with that price, you'll make a deal to it, and you'll make a payment to that. You'll basically purchase that product. And what this ABC company people will do, they'll basically ship that product to your location. At times, if it is a portable device, you'll take it with you, or you'll ask the ABC company to basically ship that product to your location. All right. And this process, we have discussed it with one person. This process continues for the other people as well. Right. This is a sales module. This module is basically making sure that the person who are interested in purchasing a desktop is converted into a person who has placed an order. In simpler terms, it is the person who is having an interest to buy a desktop has purchased a ABC computers, right? The sales module is basically focusing in that. So it is converting the leads that they have into an order placement. All right. And the next thing that we have is, once this, let's say the product has been shipped to your location, at times you have the capability of basically installing that particular device on your own, right? If it's a desktop, you know how to connect and everything, you'll be able to do it. Or at times you don't have the right skill set and the right tools with you to install that one. One simple example is you cannot install an AC machine on your own. The reason being, you don't have the right tools with you. Plus, you don't have the right skill set with you, right? If I have a drilling machine, can I drill and install my AC machine on my own? The answer might be yes and no, because I might drill a hole, which might be sufficient for the another like any or the thief to enter into my house. I might drill that much of a hole, right? So that is why what we do, we basically ask for a right skill. Hello, I'm audible now. All right. Sorry guys, there was a network issue. I just started sharing my screen. Do let me know if you have any concerns. All right, thanks. Thank you. All right, is my screen visible to everyone now? All right, awesome. Now what we do, we'll ask them for an installation. So what they'll do, they'll basically schedule an appointment with the technician, and technician would come to our house and he'll install that AC machine or a desktop, right? So we'll just stick to that example of a desktop that we are asked for the ABC company to install at their houses, right? They've installed it. Now, the mainstream of service, or the main goals of service, is to make sure that your existing customers are always happy. Your existing customers are always happy, right? So this is the process where the first thing that we have discussed is basically when your product has been shipped, you are basically asking the technician to install at the customer location, right? Now, in case if there is any issue that the customer is facing, what they'll do, they'll basically call a customer care guy, right? They'll pick up a phone and they'll call the customer care guy and they'll ask them to install that. They'll ask them to look into that issue, right? So what the customer care guy will do, they'll basically ask you some questions and they'll understand what exactly the issue that you are facing. If there is any issue that they can solve over phone, they'll give you some instructions so that you can troubleshoot the issue. If that issue is not solved over call, they would send in a technician again to your home, right? They'll send in a technician to your home. For example, if your desktop is, let's say, monitor is not working, they would send in your technician so that the technician will look at that issue. If that monitor is faulty, he'll basically replace that monitor. And if this entire thing comes under warranty, he would not charge anything. If not, he'll just basically charge you accordingly, right? So that is the flow of this CRM. This is the CRM flow that we have discussed, right? If you see, this entire story is based on one particular character. That one particular character is nothing but the customer. If you look at the marketing segment, they have targeted the people who are looking out for buying a desktop, right? They have told the people, all the people, saying that there is a new company that is an ABC that has been launched into the market and which is basically producing the desktop versions, right? Now, if you move on to the sales segment, they have converted the people who are interested in that buying a desktop into a person who placed an order with that company. Now, if you see the service segment, it is targeting the customers who are already up members, who are already existing customers to this company, by serving them if they have any issues, right? So the entire story is revolving around one particular person, which is customer. That is how you basically enhance your business. If you look at your customer needs and things, that is how you basically boost up your business. That is what the business is looking at in order to increase their extent, in order to increase the number of people and to also retain the existing people that they have, right? Now, in this process, there is a lots of information that might be coming in, right? You would be doing a YouTube ad and you will say that this ad needs to run from this day to this date. In sales, they might be asking for a discount and you shouldn't store that information, right? And if they're asking you to ship that particular product that they've purchased to a location, let's say some house address, you need to save that information in the system so that the technician or the people who are shipping to that particular location should know where exactly this needs to be shipped to, right? In service, you need to understand what is the customer issue that he is facing, and then you need to provide a resolution, and that resolution needs to be stored, right? So there is a lots of information that we will be getting in each and every phase of this segment, right? So this CRM is basically helping us save that information in a structured way. All right. So this is nothing but your customers' interactions, the company's interaction with their customers and your existing customers and potential customers, right? So this is your potential customers and this is your existing customers, right? So there is a lots of information that is coming in, and this CRM is as a kind of a solution is providing us an option to save this information so that we use this information in the right place at the right point of time, right? So I would pause here a second to understand if there are any questions. If not, we'll move on to the next slide. All right. Keeping time into consideration, I need 10 more minutes of your valuable time, right? I'll just go through all the points that we have discussed or I have promised in the starting of the session, right? 10, 15 minutes more to just go through all the points that we have. All right. So now comes the important point to understand why exactly we see. So people are asking, can you open the chat for everyone so that you can see what others are asking? So people are just basically using all panelists. So you should be able to see all the questions that they're asking. Vikas, Rana. All right. So if you scroll up, you should be able to see that. If not, people on the call from the Naresh IT, feel free to just help them out. All right. I'll take the questions towards the end. The reason being, since we have to understand few points, I'll just take the questions towards the end. Right. Maybe by that time your question should be answered during the session. If not, I'll just take it towards the end. Right. Now, why exactly Salesforce is marked as number one in the CRM? Right. This is the graph that basically shows how much dominance that Salesforce has compared to Oracle, SAP, Adobe, and Microsoft in terms of CRMs, right? So first thing is faster development. Since it is on cloud and basically Salesforce is providing kind of a solutions, right? It's providing a kind of a generically built software or kind of a solutions for each and every segment. That means marketing, we have a kind of a solution that is pre-built. And for sales, we have a pre-built solution, and service, we have a pre-built solution that are nothing but your clouds, right? Now Salesforce is providing that as an option to you. So you don't have to build the requirement from 0 to 100. Instead, you can start it from 40, right? You can use that solution. If that is solving your needs to 40%, all you need to do is build it from 40 to 100. It is not that you are starting from zero, right? I'm just taking assumed numbers here. Right. So it is the process of development would be faster. Why it is important for a client, if you say that you need five years to build a project. And by that time, if you see the first scenario that we have discussed, where the company is losing 1 month of revenue and there are like hundreds of clients every month, right? It is losing lots of money in that 5 years. Instead, they want the solution to be built in 6 months, right? So this Salesforce is facilitating that by providing the clouds to us. All right. Now, the second point is, is it cost effective? So this is cost effective and it is scalable. If you build the solution for one person or 10 person or for 30 people or for hundreds of people, it is one-time development that you need to do. And it is the licensings that you get that you should purchase. If there are 10 people that you want application to be accessed by, you just need to get that 10 licensing. If you want 100 people, you just need to get the 90 other licenses that are needed. Third important point is vision and execution. Why it is important? Salesforce initially started with the sales as a kind of a cloud, that solution that they have provided. Later, understanding the success and seeing the success of sales, they have extended it to the other sets, other clouds as well. The last important point is ability to work from anywhere on any device, right? So it is like, if I build a solution on web, it is 99% feasible with the other devices as well, where it is supported on tablet and it is supported on mobile and other devices as well. So it is a very important aspect. And if you ask me what are exactly things that I need for accessing Salesforce, or to basically build an application on Salesforce, it is the network connection, a laptop or a desktop, and a browser. These are the three important things that you need, right? So if you have these three things, you can get started with Salesforce, and you can also ask the end user to also use it the same way, right? For a developer and a end user, these are the main things that you need. Maybe during the other concept discussion, maybe if you come across a new thing where you need an external device or external thing that you need, I'll just let you know. All right. So these are the main advantages of CRM, right? Now, what coming to the advantage of Salesforce, like I said, it has a kind of a vision and execution, right? So it is innovating every year, right? So what statement, like what is that exact statement that I can give you to support this idea is, so every year Salesforce releases three releases. That means every year they would release three kind of updated versions, which means they would add certain things. Let's say if you have certain features in Salesforce, they would add new features to it, or they might add enhancements to it. So every year you'll get three enhancements like that. That means there is something new that you will see every year, right? Or every release. Now, the second one is platform. This basically brings up the discussion of Salesforce is classified into configurations and customization. In simpler terms, it is configured as admin and development, right? So what is configuration? Anything that you can do a point and click method is your admin or your configuration. I would term it as configuration rather than admin and development. Configuration is a place where you would just point and click method and get your requirement done, right? So the problem statement would be solved just by using point and click methods. You don't need to write a code there. Coming to the development or your customizations, that is where you basically write your code to get your requirement done, right? So Salesforce is saying that I am giving you with the pre-built features. That means you can get the requirements done by just by point and click method with the list of features that I have already given you. If you are not satisfied with that, that is where you'll move on to your development, which is your customization, right? So the platform is a kind of a place where you can write your code and Salesforce would be able to understand what exactly has been written, and it knows what needs to be done according to the program that you have written. All right. So platform will help us build the things which are not satisfied with the help of your configuration. All right. Productivity and mobility brings up an important aspect, right? So before I expose you people to this particular point, I would ask you a question. How many people do you think in a business, let's say if I take 100 people in a business, 100 working people in a business, how many people do you think that they have their proper desk and a chair where they can sit and enter the information that is coming in as a part of business process? If you look at real-time scenario, how many people out of 100 have their own chair, desk and a chair, or a place where they can sit properly and enter that information that comes in, right? I just want that number where it says where they have a proper desktop and a chair. So the number starts from 0 to 100. Just feel free to just share a number that comes to your mind, which basically points out to a number which says this many people have their proper desktop or desk or a chair where they can sit and enter that information, right? According to the survey, I'll reveal that answer. According to the survey that has been conducted, I see the response as 60, 40, and 60, right? According to a survey that has been conducted by Salesforce and the real-time businesses that they have seen, it is only 20% of people who have a proper chair and a desktop, chair and a desk where they can sit and enter that information. That means majority of the chunk, 80% people are on the go, right? If you ask me what are those, who are those people, they are the sales rep. They would move from one area to another area to do that sales pitch. And there are the service people or the technicians who would go from one location to another location to fix the issues with the that are being facing by the existing customers, right? So there are majority of the people who are always on the go. For them, if I ask them to basically come back to the office and then enter that information, half of the information that they have collected during the day would be gone, right? For them, they are basically, Salesforce is basically providing a kind of a mobility option where they can enter that information over phone or the devices which can be portable, and they can connect from everywhere. The earlier point that we have discussed, right? So these two points basically increase the productivity of a business by 34%, right? 34% might be a smaller number for us, but if you look from a client perspective, it is a huge win for them, right? If the productivity increases, is my voice audible to everyone? All right. Thanks, sir. So basically, the productivity increased by 34% is a huge win for the clients, right? So depending on this, mobility factor and the ability to connect from anywhere is helping the productivity raise, boost by 34%. And last but not the least of because advantages of Salesforce is community. What exactly this community factor comes into the advantage of Salesforce is we basically have 2.1 million people already using Salesforce in terms of development, right? They're like developers or the people who are doing the technical side of Salesforce, not the persons who are using that. What that means is they're the people who are using the Salesforce. That means we have a huge community of people who are already using Salesforce. That gives us two things. One is basically Salesforce is a kind of a good platform where they are using. And if we have so many people, that means they have seen something that is good and they're continuing the usage of Salesforce just because they know that there is a proper or a bright future for their careers, as well as the clients are looking also looking at Salesforce in the same view. Because if the client doesn't believe that this software is serving their purpose, they'll not ask the developers to work on this particular software. They'll ask for another XYZ software or XYZ solution. All right. So this community is a major factor that basically gives us the amount of people who are already into Salesforce and the scope of the solution or the technology that we are learning. If you see that a technology has only 14K users community, that means that either that project or that solution is a new solution or it's a kind of a solution that is at the extent of a verge of extinction. So if you see older technologies, you might not have that much of community for the technology which is a kind of well established, right? That is also a key factor that you need to look at when you are learning a new technology. All right. So I'll quickly move on to the next slide. So I have seen charts coming in which are asking more towards the requirements and all. I'll quickly move on to the next slide, which basically talks about the careers, and then I'll take up the questions. Right? I'm pretty much done with this demo. Right? This is the last slide that we have. So this is an important aspect in our discussion, which is basically understanding what exactly the terms admin and development means in the real-time scenarios. Right. So basically, if you see with a common understanding, we don't do a development in a live environment. What I mean by live environment, the live environment is nothing but an application that has been exposed to your end user, right? So let's say if some people do the development in an Amazon portal, right? We have this Amazon website, right? E-commerce website, where let's say if the Amazon people have asked the developers of the Amazon to basically do a kind of a designing directly in production, what would happen if there is any error? It would impact the entire live environment, right? All the end users like you and me would be affected. We will not be able to place our order that we wanted to place, right? Because of the error that we are facing, right? Because of that, they'll not ask the development to be happening in a live environment. Right. This is a sandbox concept. We'll understand this in detail in our day one session. I'm just giving an idea of what is a live environment. Now, if there is any issue that you are facing, let's say if you have logged into an Amazon and you're not able to do something there, what would you do? You would reach out to a customer care guy or the error would say, reach out to your admin, right? Contact your admin at this email address, right? If there is any technical issue in terms of the technology that we are using. If it is something to do with an issue with the product that you have purchased or the service that you are getting, you'll reach out to the customer care guy. This time, if there's any issue accessing with the solution or the technology that you're using, you would be asked to reach out to your admin. That admin is the person who will make sure that the live environment is stable, right? What is the job role of an admin? Job role of an admin is to maintain the live application to stabilize the live environment, to make sure that the live environment is always stable, right? So he is the person who might get a kind of a request from the end user to do so and so thing, or I am not able to access so and so thing. Please help me out with something. So he is the person who will check the backend configurations or the customizations. Depending on that, he will make sure that the end user has all the necessary information that he needs. Right? Admin is the person who will make sure that the live environment is stable, right? Or all the requests that are coming from the user are being addressed. Now, to understand this, the next role that we have, the developer and the technical architect, right? I would take an example of a building, right? So I'll compare that building with an application, right? Understand the metaphor. The application is compared with a building, right? And the person who builds that building, the mason, is nothing but your developer. The mason who builds that building is your developer. He's the person who properly lays that brick, and he'll make sure that the building comes to life, right? So basically, he is the person who implements things. Developer in Salesforce is nothing but the person who builds the requirements that comes to him, right? So mason in mason who builds the building is compared with the developer who builds an application. Now, who is this technical architect? Technical architect is the person who is nothing but, if I have to take the same example, he is the civil engineer for that particular building. He is the person who basically gives us the blueprint to the developer, saying that this is how it needs to be built, right? Technical architect is the person who looks at the bigger picture of the project and decides how the system needs to be communicated and how the implementations inside the Salesforce should be and how the things should be coming into picture, so that they can have a proper building that stays long lasting, or they can build an application which is long lasting. All right. Last but not the least, the career that we have is a business analyst. So business analyst is a person who acts like a bridge between your client and your technical team, right? So let's say if I have to take that example of a building, right? I might have a 300 square feet place. In that, my requirement is to have a lawn in front and then have a building, right? For a civil engineer, if he has given a 300 square feet, he might have an idea to basically build a building occupying the entire space. For the client here, let's say if I own that plot and I want the building to have a lawn in front, it is my requirement where I say that I need a lawn in the front, and then I should have a building, right? So it is the requirements from your client that needs to be passed to your technical team. Depending on the technical team would decide what needs to be implemented and how it needs to be implemented, right? So if the lawn is coming into the play, this information will be carried from your client to your technical team, and then that civil engineer would basically leave some space and then construct that building, right? He'll basically redesign his plan, right? So in real time, in the application building also, there might be certain requirements the client would have, and that would be passed on to your BA, and that BA would be communicating that information to your technical team. Right. This is a bigger story. As in when we go through our course, I'll let you know whenever the information would be flown in and how they basically capture that requirement and how the technical team would do that analysis. And that entire stuff, we'll discuss that whenever the time comes in our the discussion cycle, right? So I would basically highlight few points here. How much of experience do we need for individual things, right? So admin and developer can be started from zero to, so basically the requirement starts from 0 to 3 years, right? That is the base requirement. If you are in between these years, you can start as an admin or a developer. For a technical architect, at least 6 years is what they see, right? At least 6+ years is what they see, 6+ years of experience in that particular stream, where you can just not in Salesforce, but you have to have a complete overall exposure to basically get into this technical architect, right? 6+ years, maybe, or 6 to 7 or 6 to 8 years is what they look at to basically get into that technical architect. For a business analyst, it's a completely different ballgame. You need to have the domain knowledge, right? And stuff like that. And it depends on how much expertise that you have in that domain and how much of experience that you have. But usually it starts around maybe 4 to 6 years. Maybe they look at that period to basically move into that business analyst, right? So there is a kind of a years that they look at, and the number of, so why they look at years, it depends on how much experience that you gain. They take it as a base reference. There might be people who are very good at that business analyst. Maybe they might be moving on to that role within 2 years, and it all depends on how much expertise that you have. All right. So that is the end of this demo. I would just open up the session for, I would basically open up the session for the questions. All right. So I have few questions that are coming in. So I'll read it from bottom to top. Right. So I'm taking one reference from there. The last question that I've received, I'll just read it to the top. In case if I miss out any questions that you have, feel free to just ping it back. Right. Who is Salesforce rep here? Salesforce rep is nothing but a person that you look at. So if you walk into a store, there would be one person who would be accompanying you with all the information or all the questions that you have, right? So if you look, if you go to a Croma store, and basically you would ask the person that comes in to you, and you would ask him to just accompany with the information of a desktop, or you just ask him where is the laptop segment, and you would be sent to a particular section in that store, and he'll be the person who will be explaining all the specifications for that particular machines that you asked for. He's that sales rep, right? I'm just giving an example. Maybe you can just think, just expand that view to the real time scenarios that you see. All right. Hi, is there any, so Amit Das, excuse me if I'm just pronouncing your name wrong, right? His question was, is development experience mandatory, right? So yeah, people might think that admin can be managed and development is something, I would term it as admin as configuration, development as customization. So configuration would be easy because I just need to do a point and click method. Coming to customization, they think that there is a rocket science that is there, right? If you just understand this statement that I'm about to say, right? So there are certain things that you reuse every time. In the development also, you don't need to learn each and everything in the first instance, right? There is a kind of a statement that is nothing but, if you do the 20% of activities, you would be getting 80% of the results, right? Rest all 80% will give you only 20% of success, right? Same thing applies here also. There are only 20% of concepts that you need to understand in development so that you can do 80% of your work. The 80% of concepts that you need to learn will get you to the other 20% that you need to do in the real-time instance, right? So we'll basically understand what are important first to basically help you get into the development. And then I'll also leave you with other concept, 80% of concepts with the tips and tricks, so that you'll get to know the other 20% of the things that you need to get to do in the real-time environments. All right. So let me know, Amir Das, if your question has been answered. Yes, the development experience, if you have the development experience, so the technology that we'll be using is Apex. Apex is nothing but a simplified Java language that Salesforce can understand, right? It is called Apex language. If you have the development experience, that is an added bonus. If not, we'll just go from the start. The session would be from the person who doesn't know anything. We'll just address those things, right? If you have the development experience, you will be able to connect to those points, right? So if you are asking in terms of, is the development experience mandatory to join this session? The answer is no. All right. It is project oriented training, sir. The answer is yes. So I would basically look at one particular project, right? So we'll basically build small pieces in that project, right? It's just like laying one brick at a time, just like a mason, and we'll build that application at the end of the discussion. All right. I am from .NET. Shiva, I am from .NET Tech. Any prerequisite for learning Salesforce? So the prerequisites are nothing but it is like, if you can just attend the session, and if you can take something in the say take something after this session. Like, so I have not shared this slide maybe. All right. One quick thing that I forgot to share. So let me just put this up. All right. Let me know if you can see my screen. Is my PPT visible to everyone? All right. So basically, this session would be like this. Our session would be like this. So basically, if you understand the pattern of this pattern of my teaching, you would be getting to know that I always before starting a topic, I would ask certain questions, and that would help you understand what is needed, right? What is our problem statement? If you understand your problem statement, then it would be easier for you to search for an answer. If you don't know the problem statement that you are facing, it is very hard for you to basically search for an answer, right? So we would basically think from that angle, the problem angle. Why? Because why we need to think from a problem angle? Because in real-time scenarios or when you are working in projects, you would be given a problem statement or you are given a requirement. So they will be asking you. So let's say they might give you a requirement saying that how to save. The requirement would be like this. The user wants to save certain data in Salesforce and he needs these things to be saved in the system. That is your problem statement or your requirement from your client. Now what you do, that is your problem statement that is given to you. You need to decode that problem statement saying that what exactly the end user is asking you to do. The end user is asking you to save certain information in Salesforce and he wants certain things that he needs to save into Salesforce. That is your problem statement. If you decode that statement, then you'll understand what are the things that you need to do in Salesforce, which would help you solve that requirement, right? So that is what we do in the starting. Always our session would start with a question, right? That question basically helps you understand the problem statement currently that you are facing, and it also helps you understand or decode your project requirements, right? So that is what we'll start with. Then once you understand the problem statement, we'll have a theory discussion about the topic, right? So in the problem statement that we have discussed earlier, which is nothing but how to save the information in Salesforce, the answer is objects is your answer. Now we'll have a detailed discussion of what is an object and how it is and what are the classifications that we have in object. All the theoretical discussion is what we'll have. Post that, we'll have a practical session of how to basically configure that in Salesforce, right? So having a theoretical knowledge is important, as well as how to implement that is also an important. So we'll basically go through these two things. Post that, we'll understand if there are any questions from you people. If not, I'll basically give you a kind of a task towards the end, right? So I'll give you a kind of a practice towards the end of the session, so that you can basically practice that concept on your own, right? Help the aspirants to explore the concepts with the real-time hands-on experience examples. If you understand your problem statement, if you can come to a solution with that knowledge that you have gained in that class, that is what is needed, right? It is not the number of concepts that you know or the number of things that you have basically gone through, right? So it is the knowledge that you have, and it needs to be implemented in the right space, right? So the things that you learn, if you can implement, that is what is needed. Companies are looking for people who know concept and who can also implement it. There is a gap between two things, right? So this practice session will basically reduce that gap, right? All you need to do is the requirements that for this training is to basically attend the session, and second one is practice on these items. Those are the prerequisites. And why we are doing this one? So basically Salesforce has published this statement in 2018, right? And a few months back before COVID, I have attended a session and they wanted this number by 2021, 1.1 million jobs in India, right? Currently the situation is little kind of changing. The reason being there is a lots of COVID cases that are reported in America, and they're like, things are getting complicated there. So that is why there are companies which are looking for people who are working in India. This number might also increase, right? In the time of chaos, there is always an opportunity. If you can understand that statement, this number makes sense to you. So if you ask me why exactly Salesforce people are saying that they need 1.1 million jobs in India, it is because Salesforce has reached to n number of clients and they are willing to migrate to Salesforce from their respective CRMs. Remember the first issue, the ABC company, they had their fencing and they're now having a hard time tracking that information. Now this company wanted to move to Salesforce. For them to move from their existing system, that Snippy Notes and the Excel sheet, if they want to move to Salesforce, they need a technician like us, right? Technicians who know the Salesforce environment, who can basically build that application for them, right? That is why they have come up with a number saying that they need this many jobs in India by 2021, right? So these are the key factors that you need to look at, right? So I'll go back to this one. Now this statement might make sense. Why we are getting going through this course is because we want you people in that 1.1 list, right? It is not that you just attend the session and you'll again get into the dilemma of what is the next thing that you need to learn, right? So for you to get into this position, all you need to do is attend the session and practice as much as you can, right? Place this structure in a success and time graph, right? I've put that in a success and time graph. If you see, let's say if the 30 people are joining this course, everything would be same for all 30 people, right? Till this point. This is the place where if you can put in your extra effort, that defines your success, right? If there is an extra effort from you in this place, that defines your success. And how can you put in more effort? Just by spending that extra time on that particular thing, right? So time and success graph will be defined. The success of your career defines how much of time that you put in and how much of effort that you put in, right? So that is why I put in this success and time graph to demonstrate the same thing. All right. So where we are. All right, I've gone through this one. All right. So there was a question from Madhu Ganesh saying that we do have a Flipkart also, right? How Salesforce making a difference Flipkart? How Salesforce differ from e-commerce marketing advertisement? So it is not that e-commerce site that we are hosting on Salesforce. Yes, we can do connect it with another e-commerce site. It is that say the information that is flowing in from different things that comes and saves into Salesforce. That if you see, there might be a kind of a notification page that comes in. Let's say if you are waiting for a mobile that you want to purchase, it would ask you to basically enter your email address so that it can notify you, right? So that wherever you enter that information and you click on notify, that information has to be stored somewhere else, right? Now this information are all the potential customers or future customer information. That is how this information would be tracked in one place in the marketing segment, where you will track all the information, and that information will be followed by these people saying that when are the product is live, right? It is not that we are hosting a Flipkart on Salesforce. It is basically the information in different segment is coming and sitting in Salesforce. All right. I think pretty much the above questions are mainly with the prerequisites. I hope I have pretty much covered that prerequisites for now. Let me know if you need some more analysis on that. So this part, can you please open the chat? Okay. What about Salesforce support job roles? So Dinesh, if you're asking for what is a Salesforce support job role, it is nothing but the admin who basically helps that application to be in stable state, right? There might be some request that might be coming from a user where he's not able to log in into the system, and they would reach out to an admin saying that this is not happening, and these people basically provide that access to him so that he can log in into the system, right? There are like certain activities that they do, and that is where it come. It basically is classified into Salesforce support job. Let me know if that answers your question. So both technical architect and business analyst should be from a dev background. Actually, I have 6 years of this application infrastructure support using SQL development. So thinking whether to good for opt for this career. So Amir, basically it is like technical architect is the person whom these developers would reach out to if they have there any issue. Or it is like he is the person who should basically design the system. So if you are not having that expertise in Salesforce, I know that if you know SQL, there is a certain section in development where you can relate to this concept. And if you have worked in any development, let's say if you have worked in any Java or something, you should be able to relate to that quickly. If not, you can still start with that. Maybe just spend 1 or 2 years in that and then opt for a technical architect, because he is the person who should be able to resolve all the problems that are coming in day-to-day activities of a developer. So it is better to start from the developer and then move on to the technical architect if you have an understanding how the Salesforce is actually connecting and working with other environments. So how many sessions there would be to complete this course? So basically we are targeting to complete it with 2 months course. Like it is a 2 months course, right? So we will basically, I can give you the breakdown of each and everything. I hope you have got the course content, right? So it is a 2 months course is what I can say for now. Maybe when we start the session, I'll also give you a targeted end dates for each and every course so that you can plan your things accordingly. Currently I'm working at travel domain sales. Almost I have 6 years. Due to COVID I lost my job. Ashok, sorry to hear that, but yeah, you can still it's a good time for you to basically change your career, right? So if you have already worked for 6 years, maybe just try to see what all things that you have learned there and what all things that can be used, what all expertise that you can bring in from there into Salesforce. All right, it is always a good opportunity that life gives us. Just think from that perspective. All right, prerequisite. Correct pronounce. Sorry, I was not able to get what was that. Is it a good time to learn Salesforce to get a job at this experience? See, the thing is, like, if the market is demanding for people, right, since there is a kind of a chaos that is going in, people are not moving from one company to another company. Now, if the requirement comes in, they need people to get that job done, right? If you are with the right person with the right skill set, if you can just demonstrate that in the interviews, why not? Why don't they take you, right? They want people to just basically get their requirement done. If you are from a non-IT background, or if you are from a IT background, if you can do their requirement, that is all they need, right? Is there any prerequisite before? Okay, opportunities for an admin and developer. So the opportunities of an admin and a developer, configuration and customization, or an admin role or a development role, depends on how the market is behaving. If there are like more projects which are in the production state, what I mean by that is they have already developed a project and they have given that to the end customers. Now, if there are more kind of a projects that are there in the market, they need more admins. If there are more projects into the development section, they need more developments. That means they need people who need to implement the project from zero, right? In that point, they need, at that point of time, they need more developers. It all depends on how many projects that company has and what phases the projects are in, right? So this number goes up and down. At least I cannot give you a basic estimate of this many percentage of projects would be there at this point of time, right? This number goes and up up and down. The reason being, some products which are in development phase might end up into the production phase in some months, right? Do we need domain knowledge? So basically, domain knowledge is not needed. If you can just decode the requirement, what exactly the client is asking, that is needed. If you still have a domain knowledge, that is an added bonus. All right. So is it easy to understand? The answer is yes. Admin can be mastered within 15 days. And if you can spend 15 more days, you will be able to master that admin thing. Right? For development, if you put in the right practice and right amount of tips that, I mean, if you can just apply the tips and tricks that I'll tell you, you'll be able to master that in 1 or 2 months. I'm not saying that you would be able to do everything in one day. It needs time. I'll let you know how to get down that number of months that might take to master a development course to within months, right? Are you going to cover Classic or Lightning? So we would cover both, and I'll tell you when to use what and when not to use Classic or Lightning. We'll have a separate discussion on this one. Jagadhar. So interesting question, right? We'll cover both, and I'll let you know what to use or how people will be using, how people will be leveraging the items that we have in Salesforce Classic as well as in Lightning, right? All right. So it would be a daily course, Buna, right? We will connect daily. We'll see how to basically, we'll think of a strategy that we need to apply during the weekends. All right. I'm a fresher to this industry. How much minimum percentage is required? Sai Prasanna, can you rephrase that question? So you are fresher to the industry. How much minimum percentage I need required? So it depends on companies. If you are talking about the BTech degree that you are holding and the minimum percentage that you want, it should be 60 is what I know, but you can just check with the company that you are applying for. For now, for this course, there is no prerequisite for your percentage. It just depends on your company that you are applying for. All right. And that should not be a hard stop if you have a good expertise in a particular, let's say, particular technology. All right. So do you need a software and application that you need to install? Any? So it is just that if you have a desktop or a laptop, it has an internet connectivity. And if you have a Chrome browser, that is all the things that we need to have. In case if you need to have a third party application, I'll let you know. As of now, we can do everything just by using these three things. All right. So a similar question of that Flipkart and the Salesforce discussion that came in. So I think I've answered that. So what are the programming languages involved in a development role? So basically the programming language that we have is Apex. Right, and we will be also introduced with the JavaScript, CSS, and the HTML technologies when we are designing that UI. We'll touch the things which are needed, and I'll also give you a kind of a place where you can just get this information easily. Right, so it is all on me, just that you need to practice from your end. Is Java enough for Salesforce development? Yes. Okay, but I hope I can start working from admin. Yes, if you are thinking of just opting for an admin, think from this perspective. If you don't know what are the things that you can do with the development, just by learning one thing doesn't make any sense. If you know both things and then you apply for a job for admin, that makes sense, because you tell that the client or the person who is giving you the requirements, if he's saying that it should be done with an admin or just by configuration, you will simply say that because of this reasons, this cannot be done using admin. You'll tell them that, okay, it has to go with the development. Then he will be in a position to basically give that requirement to a developer rather than giving it to you, right? So that knowledge of what can be done with an admin and with your development is very important. So because Rana, we are planning to just keep it to Monday to Friday. If you people are interested, maybe we can think of having a 7 days a week. So Bhuvanath, the material and the slides would be shared with you. Yes, maybe you can just reach out to the concerned people. I'll just share that information. Maybe our Naresh IT team, can you just take this question of slides and the recording part? Is the lightning is also included? The answer is yes, we'll include that. And depends on the thing that you're asking. Just feel free to, for the details on the days plus the course content and everything, feel free to reach out to the Naresh IT people. They should be helping you out with the information. All right. So testing concepts, basically we'll touch base on the unit testing, which is very important. The reason being, if you develop an application, if it is basically, you think that it is working, but when you test it, if you find that it is failing, then there is no point of releasing it to the higher orders, right? It is always a good practice to have a understanding of how to test the things. What I mean by testing here is the unit testing, right? We'll just understand those things as well. So Durga Prasad, like if you have experience in marketing, yes, you can still learn Salesforce. Maybe if you are not, if you are from a non-IT background and if you have not basically come across any technology that you have learned, maybe it might be a little difficult in the starting. Let's say you need to put in that extra effort. If you can put in that extra effort, why not? Why can't you just move to Salesforce? All right. I've seen people who are from a testing background, who are from non-technical background, moving into Salesforce. Just that they have put in that extra effort that is needed. Let's say if people are working for 1 hour, they have spent that extra half an hour to get the things sorted out, or to just get the understanding of it and how to implement it. So Manasa Koduri, maybe the career gaps doesn't make any sense to attend this course. It just that maybe during the interviews, just that you need to justify why you have taken that career gap, right? So career gap is not a bigger issue, right? Until unless if you can just justify why you had to take that career gap, it is a one question that is been asked in an interview. If you can just handle that with grace, no one will be having any issues taking you. All right. So Madhu Ganesh, as of now, we are not taking LWC as a kind of a, we are not providing LWC in this one. The reason being, it is a little advanced. And if you don't have a proper understanding of the other things, it is like chasing for something which is not in your range, right? Which is not in your scope. All right. So LWC is the latest version. Right. So maybe if you are interested, maybe we can plan a different session. But as of now, as far as I would, as a friend, if I have to give you a suggestion, don't run for something which is very kind of an advance. Just get the things sorted. Just get the things which are needed for get to your job, and then maybe focus on these items. All right. So the end goal is to get a job. Then maybe we can think of advanced things that we need to learn. All right. So this is not for just for Madhu Ganesh. It is for everyone. So our end goal is to get a job. Think of that perspective. If you get the right things that are needed to crack a job, that is needed first, and then you can increase your knowledge depending on that. Right. If I know just let's say till A to, let's say A to D, right? A, B, C, D. Only I know these things, right? I need to get into a job where I only see these things, right? So I just need to opt for a question paper which basically has A, B, C, D's, right? I don't need to get into a thing where I need to fill out something there. I should not opt for a blanks, like let's say a question paper which has blanks where I need to write out something, right? So it is that understanding that you need to have. The example might not make sense, but you get that idea. You just need to target what you need to have to crack a job, right? If you focus on those items first, get that job done, get that job first and then spend some extra bucks to understand other things, or then spend an extra time to understand what you have not covered so far, right? Your learning should be a kind of a cumulative process rather than doing everything at once and then searching for a job, right? If that makes sense, take this as a kind of a, as a kind of a suggestion, and think in that perspective. First goal is to get a job and then think of something that you need to learn, right? All right. I think I've pretty much covered all the questions. Let me know if you have missed any questions. So we are almost on the top of that. It was a nice session with you all the guys. The questions were interesting, right? If you have any questions, I'll stay for another 5 minutes. Keep the questions coming in. So if I've missed out anything, just do let me know. I've pretty much covered all the questions that came in. At least that is what my understanding is. Let me know if I have to go back and see if I've missed out anything. All right. Awesome. Thanks, guys. So if you have any questions, reach out to the Naresh IT team and they should be able to help you with all the questions related to the timings and the course content and other items which are dependent with these courses. Right? Feel free to reach out to them. In case if you have any technical questions, feel free to reach out to them and they would send me a consolidated question list so that I can answer them to you via other means, other modes of communication. All right, guys. Thanks, everyone. Have a good day. Bye-bye.